we need to have the same things, you know, say we need to have the same qualities, we need to...
I'm talking about the doping. Nowadays, doping test.
Pardon?
Doping.
No, doping. I heard it as Gopi. So, I thought you were asking about Gopichand. So
I'm talking of the doping.
No, that is a, you know, it's very unfortunate. You know, like, in fact, you know, our time it was unheard of. But I think it's very unfortunate that, you know, nowadays, because of commercial reasons, you know, sports, it's not the same. You know, like we said, you know, I played for the love of it. You know, it didn't matter, you know, whether I made it big or not. Because even otherwise, sports teaches you a lot of good things. You know, playing team sports, everybody need not play sports, you know, only to become champions. You know, it teaches you a lot of good things, discipline, dedication, team effort, and more than anything else, you learn to lose. You know, people who have played sport, you know, they realize that, you know, when you play games, every time, even at the club level or college level, class level, you know, you learn. You sometimes, maybe most of the time, or sometimes you lose. So when you go in the corporate world or even in life, you know, they realize that every time you cannot win, every time you cannot have your way, sometimes you lose. So people who have played sport, I feel that, you know, they accept things, you know, it comes naturally, okay, it's there. So now I need to see, you know, why I have lost, what do I need to do better? So they accept defeat in a much more sporting way, rather than, you know, like somebody who's not played a sport. They find it difficult to understand, you know, why is this, you know, or, you know, this one is not listening to me, that one is not listening to me, why, how can, you know, what I say can be wrong. You know, people who have not played sport, I think, have that distinct, but that was in the olden days. But now, you know, I think it's all commercialization, or there's so much money into sport, people are prepared to do anything, even at, you know, I think the risk of their life. Because, you know, doping and all, you know, they to get an Olympic medal, you know, they'll go to any extent. But, you know, it can have a lot of consequences 10 years, 15 years, 20 years down the line. You don't know what, you know, you can, you know, be, but they don't think of all that, you know. So it's very unfortunate that, and, you know, they are always ahead. People who dope, or, you know, you know, the system is always behind. You know, they're trying to stop, but they are 2-3 steps ahead. So, but it's most unfortunate, but, you know, something which everybody should totally avoid. Be absolutely on normal, natural, you know, whatever you can. And whatever you can achieve, you achieve that. It doesn't matter. Everybody does not have to, somebody else is cheating, so I also cheat. No, I won't advise that. You know, if let them cheat, let them face the consequences. You know, without cheating, if you can do, I think your aim should be to follow all the rules and yet be the best in the world. I think that will be my, if it is possible or not, that's a different thing. It is possible, but maybe you'll have to put in a little more effort. You need to be more, you know, put in a more effort than somebody else. But even if you, at the end of the day, you don't achieve that, it's not worth taking the risk of, you know, like doing unethical things and, you know, trying to achieve fame. Because, you know, I'm not, you know, I belong to a generation where, you know, I don't, you know, you have to win fair and square. It has to be, you know, victory by fair means.
Sir, I am Mallikarjunappa from Mangalore University. Did you at any point of time, in retrospect, feel that you missed your family, or the other way, your family was missing because of your professional career? That's number one. Number two, as you have very relevantly put it, today there is a lot of money in sports, in various sports. The moment a person achieves even a small championship, the media comes, modeling world comes, and then brand ambassador. Do you think these things are distracting the sportsman to achieve the pinnacle? Then the third one, government is also coming out with a lot of schemes to encourage the sportsman. Why India has not been able to produce a large number of champions, perhaps champions like you? Let me also add a personal note that when you won All England champion, we heard that in the radio news. Next day, entire newspaper and then the magazines we read, and all of us rejoiced. So we are proud of you. So what is your views on these 3 years?
I think issues? You say one by one.
Number one is your family. Did you, in retrospect, feel, now sitting back now, did you feel that you have missed your family, your children as well as you? And then they feeling that you have not been able to give adequate time.
I think one has to draw a balance. You know, like I said, you know, when you are a professional, if you want to achieve excellence, you want to be at the topmost, you have to be prepared to sacrifice. So that is one of the sacrifices you have to make as a player. You cannot have both. So, and then of course, you know, now that I've retired, I try to make up whatever time I couldn't spend with them, like during their when they were growing up, so that family, of course, they do miss it. It's not like a normal family, but I have no regret, I have no complaints, because I could not have achieved, to be at the highest level. The one other thing which I forgot to mention, like I think the lady there asked, if you want to reach the top, or to reach international level in any field, I think you have to be very selfish. That is very important. People might say anything, but if you are not selfish, you cannot be the world number one. You cannot think of anything else. Everything you have to think is myself. About me, myself. Whatever I want, I'll do. Whatever I want, I'll get. If you are not selfish, I'm not saying it, otherwise. But in your own field, to achieve excellence, you have to be selfish. I'm not saying that you don't help others and all that, but that may not be the right word, but you have to think only about yourself. You cannot think of anybody else. Then you will, be somewhere in between. So most players have to be, if you want to achieve excellence, which means again, you have to be prepared to sacrifice somewhere down the line. And then, when you have the time, you spend time with them, a reasonable amount of time when certain, some birthdays, you may not be there. Sometimes, these days, even when, child is born, a player may not be there, they might be traveling in some tournaments. So these are some of the things which you should be able to forego. And, to the extent possible, try to balance it out, so that, not that whole year you are out and, the complete, their childhood you are away. And, especially if you have a choice. Sometimes if you don't have a choice, you can't help it, family is somewhere and, it's totally another country, and even there you try to manage. So, that way, one of the sacrifices you have to make. What was the second point? But I have no regrets.
Yeah, since there is a lot of money these days, even if a person achieves small things, there is a modeling world which will come to you, and then the brand ambassador, all these things are coming. Do you think these things are distractions for the sports people to achieve?
No, not really. See, like I said, it's up to the sports person. The sports persons need to be educated. Like I said, don't aim small. Like if you win a state level, district level, there are so many, you have to keep aiming for higher things. So don't be satisfied, if you win one tournament, so the press comes, okay, there's still more to achieve. So, the way of looking at it is, so because it happens, so don't give them any support. Don't, there should not be any publicity, there should not be any money, they'll get spoiled. So don't do, I don't think that's the way. The better way would be to, these things are there, but you educate the right sports persons that these things are there, but you can achieve much more. Aim for bigger laurels, bigger rewards, bigger financial benefits, bigger aims, rather than being happy. I think sometimes the parents or the children, they don't do it intentionally. They do it out of ignorance. They don't realize that they have a potential. Nobody has told them that, so I think the right way of looking at it is to try to educate children, not be satisfied with, you can achieve a lot more. So focus on that, and this is just by passing. So I think a better education in all fields, probably that would be the way forward.
The third one I asked is, in spite of the government and private sector supporting the sportsperson so much, why India has not been able to produce world-class sportsmen? Unlike countries like China, which has produced large number of sport persons.
Yes. No, that's because we have not put systems in place. It's only coming now. The Chinese, the system is very different. their sport starts at a very base school level itself. They are so well organized. They put good systems in place. So it is not individual centric. Like here we have one academy, Gopi's Academy or my academy, producing all the champions. But there maybe they have 100 academies like that. So, whenever there is a talent, and it's all state funded, done by the federation, done by the association. Here, ours is privately funded. So we need the right kind of people, right kind of support. You know, if you put systems in place, you know, that's for the federations to do, you know, like broad-based the sports at the grassroots level, you know, the talent spotting at the right age, then put them to, you know, the right, you know, if they're talented here, they go to the next stage, they go to the next stage, you know, they, so, you know, that very systematic way of identifying talent and nurturing and supporting them. So that is not there at the overall, you know, the national level. We have to depend on individuals. The results are very, very, you know, even though we have the talent, you know, the talents are not being identified. Even identified talent will not get the right kind of support. And even if they get, they'll not get at the right time. If they get, if they'll not get at the right age, because of which many of them, you know, stop playing. Lot of favoritism, you know, there's no professionalism in sports federations. So a lot of multiple factors which, you know, China is not, you know.
Can I ask one more question?
Yeah.
Yeah. Sir, as a sportsman, how did you feel when North Korean president started talking about their North Korea. In the last Olympics,
yeah.
North Korea had set 15 gold medal as their target. They did not achieve. Then the president said somebody who has won bronze would be asked to work in, let's say, coal mine. He said that after they come back, I'll send them to coal mine. Then those who achieve the silver, they would be asked to work in the iron ore mines. So some of these things. As a sportsperson, how did you feel? Because do you think these are the perversions at the highest level? This is the president of a country imposing these things on the sportspersons of their countries.
No, so
and one poor sportsperson has to, he had to run away. And they have given a diktat, kill him wherever he is found. What did you feel as a sportsperson?
No, I think that, I think it's not even worth discussing, because you know, North Korea, China, they are, you know, two countries where whether it is good or bad, we cannot implement them. It's humanly not possible, because you know, it's a totally different. So I think we have to be practical, and you know, it's definitely not, you know, like different societies, different nations have different cultures and you know, different forms of government. So it is, while it is probably very common, you know, in that country, no way it can it can implement here, and it will never happen. And so like even in China, you know, like lot of the, we see only the elite, you know, for every one athlete who comes, maybe there are about 1,000, you know, who you know, because the children, they are literally, you know, there is, it's more like a military kind of, you know, it's a lot of things which cannot be implemented here in a democratic country where, you know, parents have a lot of say. And you know, there, if some, you know, 1,000 children are, you know, if one child is selected, I think they have to go to a school, you know, and then the parents have no say. So, you know, such system, even if they produce 100 Olympic golds, we cannot follow that system here because of, you know, the, because the nature of our, you know, country, or the way we are governed. So these are, you know, we should only take which are implementable here in our country. You know, some systems, you know, like the good system which they put in place, identifying talent at the school level, yes, that is possible. You know, then from school level, they go to district level, then to state level, then zonal level, then national level. So they put very good systems in place for all sports. So all that is possible. But that has to be done by the government and the national federations. But some of the other things, like you mentioned, I think is... It's very sad, I think, and it should not happen, and I think definitely will not happen in our country at least.
What are the hurdles you faced as an Indian sportsman as compared to the contemporaries from other countries? Indian sportsman as compared to the contemporaries of other countries?
Well, I think nowadays there is not much. You know, we are probably a little behind in terms of science support and all that infrastructure. Maybe, you know, other countries, means it depends. You know, if you are talking of advanced countries like US, Europe, maybe they have, you know, better access to, you know, some infrastructure or sports science support, you know, in terms of nutrition. Because nowadays, you know, it's not just, if you are good in your own sport, it's not enough. You know, you need a lot of scientific support now. You know, the nutrition, trainer, physios, you know, sports psychologist, you know, masseur. So they all go as a team, doctors. Video analysis, so they also play a very important part. So, you know, in the science support system, maybe we are a little behind, maybe 10 years behind. So in that way, we are slowly coming there, but they are very well advanced. You know, some of the Europeans and the Americans. So that could be one of the reasons why, you know, they're doing so well. But again, you know, this thing would be happy with whatever we have, and yet we have to be the best. So, you know, think very positive, and maybe you'll have to put in more effort than they do, and you can still achieve the same results. So I don't see any, you know, things are looking up, you know, because compared to, let's say, 5 years or 10 years back, I think Indian sportspersons are in a good shape. You know, a lot of you know, government incentives, a lot of money being spent on equipment, on exposure, on camps. So I think it's a good time to be, and things are only looking up, going, you know, a lot of press coverage, you know, other than cricket, a lot of other sports being recognized. Olympic sports are getting the recognition. So on the whole, I think I think a lot more positives, and I think one has to look at it very positively.
Good evening, sir. I'm Kavya Vaidya. I'm a student of this institute. My question is, what management student can take home as learning sports?
Pardon?
What can management students take home as a learning from sports? What can management students take home as a learning from sports?
Management students?
Yes, sir.
You tell me, you listen to me for 1.5 hours. You can... that will be my question to you. All of you can discuss and tell me what all have you learned?
Dedication?
Yes. And what else?
Determination.
Group discussions.
Hard work, focusing.
Yes, yeah, so all that is. No, besides that.
No complaints.
Yes, then what else? You know the answers. Think positive, self-belief.
Never blaming on others.
Yeah. Basically, these are some of the, you know, common factors.
Self-confidence.
Yes. Good enough.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
If not badminton, what were your other interests?
I'm fond of music. Music is my only way of, you know, I listen to a lot of old Hindi songs. You know, I'm classical, because that's what gives me, you know, I can relax. So music, I don't sing myself. I mean, I don't play any instruments. I don't sing at all. But I like to listen to music, so that's one way of, you know, that's one way I relax. Even during my playing days, even during tournaments, I used to have a Walkman, or, you know, I used to listen to music, and I used to relax. So basically, you know, some attend plays, watch some movies, read little bit. So these are some of my hobbies.
Thank you, sir.
Prakash, with your permission, I would love to play the acceptance speech of your daughter.
Yeah, sure.
In the Filmfare Award
function. Sure, sure.
Would it be okay?
Sure.
Dedicate this award to my parents, and I'm going to read out, take 2 minutes of your time, please, and read out a little letter that I found that my father wrote to me and my sister a couple of years ago, and I felt that it was apt to read out, especially because this award is for Pico. So please bear with me for 2 minutes. Dear Deepika and Anisha, you stand on the threshold of life's journey. I want to share with you some lessons that life has taught me. Decades ago, as a little boy growing up in Bangalore, I started my tryst with badminton. In those days, there were no stadiums and no courts sports people could train in. Our badminton court was the wedding hall of the Canara Union Bank near our house, and it was there that I learned everything about the game. Every day we would wait to see if there was a function in the hall, and if there was none, we would rush there after school to play our heart's content. Looking back, I realized that the most important thing about my childhood and adolescent years was my refusal to complain about a lot in life. I was thankful for the few hours a week we had the opportunity to hit the shuttle back and forth. In fact, the foundation on which I based my career and my life was the refusal to whine and whine about everything. And that is why, and that is what I want to tell you, my children, that there is no substitute for perseverance, hard work, determination, and passion for what you do. If you love what you do, nothing else matters. Neither awards, ironic I say that here, nor compensation, not even the gratification of seeing your face in newspapers or television. When I won the All England Championship, the prize money in badminton became significant, £3,000, a huge amount in those days, but that did not distract me from the sheer joy of having been instrumental in putting India on the global map for this game. Deepika at 18, when you told us that you wanted to shift to Mumbai for a career in modeling, we felt you were too young and too inexperienced to be alone in a big city and in an industry we knew nothing about. In the end, we decided to let you follow your heart, though and thought it was cruel to not give our child the opportunity to go after a dream that she lived and breathed for. If you succeeded, it would have made us proud, but even if you didn't, you would not have any regrets that you didn't try. The amount of effort that I put in my game never varied from the first day till my retirement. Even during my toughest times, I focused on what I had. Please bear with me. Instead of dwelling on what I did not. I had the ability to make the best of the worst circumstances and remain steadfast to my goal. Remember how I constantly tell you both about the importance of making your way up in the world without waiting for your parents to pull strings? I believe it is best for children to work hard to make their dreams come true and to not have things handed to them on a platter. When you are visiting home, Deepika, you make your own bed, clean the table after meals, and sleep on the floor if there are guests at home. If you occasionally wonder why we refuse to treat you like a star, it's because you are our daughter first and a film star later. The cameras that follow you everywhere and the arc lights will eventually fade, and what will remain is the real world. Deepika, I have learned that you can't always win in life, that everything you want might not come your way, that events do not always turn out the way you want them to. To win some, you have to lose some. You have to learn to take life's ups and downs in your stride. You are in an industry where there is a lot, but I hope that you are the game changer in it. Strive to generate positivity around you, even though you're too new and too small a player to effect a big change. You are in an industry where there's always going to be a lot of money, but I believe that it is important to be able to be the best in whatever you do, regardless of the money. The things that really matter in life are relationships, honesty, respect for your parents and elders. Material success is important, but not fundamental to happiness and peace of mind. I can't tell you enough about the rejuvenating power of prayers and a little faith. Spare a few minutes of your day to close your eyes and meditate, to think about God, and you will see how much faith in His power will strengthen you. In the end, when your career is behind you, what remains is family, the friends that you have made. Live a life that is healthy and one that will allow you to live with your own conscience. Everything else is transient, and remember, no matter what, we're always going to be there for you. Lovingly, Papa. Sorry that took a while, but the fact that the black lady's in my hand tonight because of a film like Piku, I felt it was important to share that little note that coincidentally I found in my drawer just a couple of days ago. And I think on behalf of every child, I want to thank our parents for being the people that they are. I promise you that all of us are going to try and be the best that we can be. And most importantly, thank you for being you, and thank you for allowing me to be me and to pursue my dreams. Thank you.
Tears in many of their eyes.
Yeah, yeah.
We should make them laugh when they are going out.
Pardon?
So we should make them laugh
when
they go out. So shall I start with the anecdote? Okay. I heard Deepika once say that my father had a big crush on whom? On whom? Madhuri Dixit. Is it true?
Yeah, absolutely true. It's a secret which the whole world knows.
One confession which I have to make is, I also had crush on her.
Oh.
Right? My favorite was, Dhak Dhak Karne Laga.
Yeah.
Beta,
yes.
What was your favorite?
Ek Do Teen.
I think they had a feel.
Yeah, sure.
As usual, my dear students, what is it we learned from this exercise, whole exercise? One, you may come from very small places. You may not have gone to a public school. You would have gone to a municipal school or government school, whom we are thinking infradig today, right? But if you work hard, we used to say in the past, sky is the limit, because at that time, we had never thought of going to moon. Now we are talking about going to moon, so sky is not the limit. There is no limit for your expansion. If you think you will not go out of your zone of comfort, and if it is Mangalore, you will end up with a menial job with a salary of 10,000 without any future or without any target. So what you have to do, you should always think of going out of your zone of comfort. This is exactly what he did when he not only went, he took his wife also with him, so that things will happen. He also said you should have a big dream. Now, without a big dream, you are not going to land anywhere. It is not enough if you have a big dream. You should work hard and try to reach the pinnacle in that particular thing. This is what he did when he was studying, when he was working in Union Bank, and many other things. So, if you really have a big dream and you work for that, nobody can stop you, right? Lastly, he said, once you reach the pinnacle, you should give back whatever better things you have received. And for that, he started the academy, which is training out so many other people, so many other champions in the days to come. Prakash, it was a great day. I would say, I think all of you agree. Can we give him a standing ovation?
Thank you.
You.
Short video clipping was a small surprise from Sri V. Leeladhar, sir. Thank you so much, sir. I'm sure our audience have learned a lot through your message. Audience, it was a wonderful session. I'm sure that our young minds have gained a lot of knowledge by listening to your invaluable experiences, sir. Feeling gratitude and not expressing it is like wrapping a present and not giving it. I now call upon Mr. Ayush Kothari, student of second year MBA, to propose the vote of thanks.
Some people make the world special just by being in it. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I, Ayush Kothari, on behalf of MSNM Besant, have the pleasant task of delivering the vote of thanks to this